So good morning, everyone. Welcome to this Workforce Wednesday webinar. My name is Kirsten Bayer, and I am with the Illinois Center for Specialized Professional Support at Illinois State University. I will be on for technical support and facilitation today. I am joined by Jasmine Williams, who will be presenting today on industry insights, exploring job market statistics, and certification demands. So we are excited to hear from her on her presentation. We will have multiple opportunities for Q&A today throughout the presentation. You can type any questions or comments for Jasmine in the chat or in the Q&A function, or you can feel free to hold your questions and ask them live when we pause for that option. To ask a question live, you would simply raise your hand on your virtual Zoom toolbar, and then I have the capability to unmute you. With that being said, you do not have the ability to unmute yourself or turn on your cameras as we are on the Zoom webinar platform, which is more of a presenter audience formatted platform. However, like I said, during those times for live Q&A at the end and throughout the presentation when Jasmine pauses, we will have the opportunity for you to unmute yourself and I can control that and give you your camera back. Just let me know that you, or give you your microphone back, excuse me. Just let me know that you have a question by raising your hand, your virtual Zoom hand, and I will unmute you. We are having this webinar recorded today, and the recording will be posted on Illinois WorkNet, as well as our center's website that we house, which is IllinoisWorkforceAcademy.com, and I'll put that URL in the chat towards the end of the session. We will also have a follow-up survey today that we ask that you participate in. I personally sit on the WIO Professional Development Committee that comes up with the Workforce Wednesday webinar topics and finds presenters for them. And we do look at your feedback on a quarterly basis on the surveys and go through it to see where the industry really needs, what gaps you all have and where you need professional development. And we try to meet you where you're at. So if you have a future topic for PD that you would like to see, you can feel free to fill out that survey and then we do compile that data. Or if you do not wish to take the survey, which I do understand, but I do entice you to do, you can feel free to email me and I'll put my email in the chat. If you have a future topic for PD that you would like to do a session on, we welcome your suggestions. And then I will get us started here with just some beginning polls that we do every Workforce Wednesday webinar. If you're familiar with our Workforce Wednesday webinars, if you've been on one before, you are familiar with these polls. But the first one is, where is your local area? So we would just like to know where you're joining us from today. We want to make sure we're reaching the whole state of Illinois because that is our target audience. We want to provide PD for the whole workforce system and all of our core partners across the state. So we'll give everyone a couple seconds to answer this poll. While we're finishing answering this poll, another housekeeping item that I have is that tomorrow you will receive a follow-up survey, which will have, or a follow-up email, excuse me, that will have the follow-up survey link in it, as well as the URL link to the website where you can find the recording and today's presentation slides. So you will have all the follow-up materials from today's webinar if you need them. I'll go ahead and end that poll and share the results. It looks like we have a good span across the state, like pretty much even numbers across the state, which is awesome that we're meeting everyone. And then the second poll that we do is just which partner you're, you best represent today. So if you best represent Title 1, 2, 3, or 4, or other WIO partner and stakeholder, or a state or local workforce innovation board member. So we'll give everyone a couple more seconds to answer that. A couple more seconds. Okay, let's go ahead and end that. Looks like we have a lot of Title I and other WIO partner and stakeholders, as well as some Title II and Title III people and a Title IV person as well. So we got a good sprinkle across all of our four partners, which is awesome. So So thank you for answering those polls. I am going to be here throughout the session. If anyone needs anything, you can feel free to reach out to me via the chat. And then I will hand it off to Jasmine Williams to introduce herself and start her presentation.
Certainly. Thank you so much, Kirsten. Again, my name is Jasmine Williams. I'm a senior policy analyst at the Chicago Cook Workforce Partnership. On the next slide, you see just a few details about my day-to-day work. I do manage all of the data requests that might come in. So from our internal, from our mandated partners, as well as just non-mandated partners, really anyone who asks, I manage those data requests. I undertake a lot of research projects. So I'll talk a little bit about some of the research projects that I've done that are related, that maybe can be applicable to this, and then a lot of the grant writing. So as you know, that is a big part of our work. And so those are some of the tasks that I do at the partnership. And I'm really excited to be here today. On the next slide, you'll see the agenda. It's pretty high level. We'll start with just understanding job market statistics and some of the top occupations and industries, employers in our region. And then we'll talk a little bit about popular certifications across industry. So we're going to be looking at various industries, kind of our top eight, and looking at the certifications, looking at the occupations that are associated with those. And then finally, closer towards the end, we'll do some talk about some free resources that are available to you and ways that we can use these statistics in our program development efforts. And I'd love for people to ask questions throughout. I think about halfway through, I'll stop and just give people a chance to chime in. That way, you don't have to wait all the way till the end to ask a question if it's something that comes up kind of maybe in the beginning of the presentation. So we can jump right into what is LMI. On the next slide. So LMI is short for labor market information. It's just another way to say job market statistics. And it is the size and characteristics of a labor market. It tells us a lot about the demand for and the supply of labor. So if a new company wants to move somewhere, they may want to find out how many workers are there, how many people are there that already have this particular skill set. That they may be looking for. So it's also the education, skills, and training needed. It's also wage information, right? So how much does an industry or an occupation pay in your place, as well as the top employer. So that is a high-level definition of labor market information and who uses it. So on the next slide, lots of different people can use it. It's definitely a term that I never used before workforce development, but job seekers use labor market information, right? When they're asking people, hey, what's it like at your job? Are they hiring? Do a lot of people work there, or is it just a one-man type of job? So career seekers use labor market information to make decisions. Employers certainly use it when they're figuring out how much they want to pay people, right? What does a position pay? How many people are going to be available to work? Investors can use it. Policymakers can certainly use it. Workforce development professionals like us can use it, and really anyone who has an interest in learning about a particular occupation or industry could use labor market information to make good decisions. So where could we find it? Where do we get this information? There's actually a lot of places to get it. Kirsten, on the next slide, I've listed some of the places. So we got the U.S. Census Bureau, we've got the Bureau of Economic Analysis, the Bureau of Labor Statistics, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in depth, as well as IDES, ONET. And the last one I listed is a labor market information tool called Lightcast. So this is what I use for the majority. I won't say the majority, but yeah, for a good portion of the data requests that I manage. So Lightcast is a paid tool. So if the first tools that I listed, the first seven of those are obviously free, open to the public. You go on the website. There's some really good information there, but at the same time, sometimes it can be difficult or challenging to kind of really break it down to your local area if you're really wanting to know what is it like in Chicago or in Carbondale, Illinois, or if you have more specific questions, especially when it comes to a specific place, sometimes it's helpful to use a paid tool. So Lightcast pulls information from thousands of different sources. It's one of those basically like a web scraper. So job boards like Indeed, like Career Builder that have thousands and thousands of postings, it is actually scraping those for information about the skills, looking for trends and the skills that they're asking for and the hiring requirements, looking for trends about pay, like giving us information about pay. And then on the back end, when we look at like the Census Bureau stuff, it's also pulling in all of that information that really can help us get some strong demographic data about people. So it's not just, there's so many different things to labor market, right? Like, so it is the industries, it is the employers, and then it's also who is working in those industries, right? How many of them are Black, how many of them are white, how many of them are over 40, how many of them are under 40? So all of these, there are all these different characteristics about the labor market that are relevant that you can learn from these tools. So on the next slide, what can we learn, right? What jobs and careers are out there? What jobs or careers may be available in the future? So we do have some tools that allow us to do projections and see what is going to be big in the next 10 years. What are the growing or trending sectors? So what things have really increased jobs in the last, year, 5 years, 10 years? What do jobs pay and which employers are hiring? So I'm going to dive right into this quarterly report that I produce for the partnership. On the next slide, I kind of have bits and pieces of this report. So this report is called the Where Are the Jobs Report. And what it is a quarterly review of all the job postings in Cook County. And it's really just an analysis of those jobs. So here we see in the last quarter, so this represents quarter one of this year, so January to March. We see 236,000 job postings. And these are grouped by occupation. So just to put a pin right there, occupation versus industry, right? Your occupation could be very different than the industry. Sometimes they match. Sometimes I am a nurse. And so I have a healthcare occupation and I work in the healthcare industry at a hospital, but I also could be a nurse and work at a school, right? So I'm actually in the education industry, not the healthcare industry, but my occupation is still the same. So these 236,000 job postings have been grouped by occupation, and healthcare reigns at the top, next to management. So management is a bit of a tricky one because it spans across fields. So you could be a manager, you could be the manager of a store, or you could be the manager at a power plant, right? So these are just some high-level numbers, but we see healthcare is at the top, and then we see a number of other fields to just let us know, there's over 20,000 job postings in information technology, over 18,000 job postings in both office and admin and business and finance. So these are actual live, postings that are active from that are currently active in that quarter. On the next slide, we have our top employers by industry. So just to put a pin right here, now we're looking by industry, and there's some interesting things I always find in here. I'll draw your attention to manufacturing, for instance. If you notice, there are some food companies in here. So Kraft was the number one employer in Cook County in the manufacturing industry. Newlyweds Foods, Coca-Cola Company. I think there's only one employer here who does not produce food. So that's something to think about and talk about when we're kind of in a discussion place. But so many industries are changing. Now food and manufacturing, they're just different. Food used to be food, but now there are so many more food manufacturers that are entering the game that it's just a bigger industry. It's really changing the face of manufacturing, aside from all the technological advances, where it's just not the same type of industry anymore. But to go back to the top under business financial, and we put out this every quarter, so it's always interesting to see which employers are consistent, and you kind of see the same ones every time. And then it's always interesting to see when they change, right? So Wintrust, JP Morgan, Capital One, these are a lot of your big banks that you've heard of. Food service, McDonald's, the Marriott, Aramark. They're a different type of, they're more of a hospitality group. Aramark's got big contracts with schools, with stadiums. It's not your typical like Starbucks, right? So I won't read each one, but these are the top employers by job postings. So let me know if you have any questions on this. Retail, Walgreens, Amazon, CVS. And so we'll move on from this, but those are your top five employers by industry. On the next slide, we want to look at some industry projections. So again, I pulled this data from Lightcast. Sure. Rory, go ahead. Let's take a quick pause. I would love a question. Kirsten, if you could allow Rory to unmute himself.
Yes, hold on 1 second. Rory, you should be able to unmute yourself now.
Oh yeah, sorry. I sent the question to Kirsten and you guys to ask if it's okay to ask the question, because this might be something that I was going to ask to put in the and if people want to put in the chat, but it might be off topic. Like I didn't want to interrupt or distract from your presentation, so I was just asking if it would be okay to ask later on. But we use we've used for, gosh, I don't know, at least maybe 5 or 7 years, Jobs EQ, which is a product of Chimera Economics and Analytics company. I like a lot of their weekly updates and a lot of the tools, the way I can customize stuff. But I was just curious if anybody out there, or if you yourself, if your area has used that before you switched to either or before you used MC or Lightcast, because Lightcast, I get a lot of their blogs and their reports. They look like they've got a lot of good stuff. And I, it's one of those things like you're comfortable with one tool, but you always wonder if one is doing a little bit better, because like you said, getting that localized even wage data, there's great sources through IDES and BLS and quarterly Census Employment Wages. But as we know, I mean, there's data lag when that's available, even at the state level, much less at the local or sub-state level. So having one of those tools like, Lightcast, which used to be MC and Burning Glass, or Jobs EQ is great. But I was just curious if you've used either or. But again, this is something I was going to maybe like, if anybody wanted to say, put in the chat, like if they would recommend, one or the other, that's fine. I didn't mean to detract from, in the middle of your slide. Sorry about that.
No, that's totally fine. I have heard of Jobs EQ, but I have not used it to give you. I really do enjoy Lightcast, and if you were ever interested in doing doing a quick call where I could just show you around like a Zoom call, and you could look around and at least see some of the see some of the things you're able to do, that I would certainly be open to that, but I have not used Job EQ to be able to give you a solid comparison, to a solid comparison. Okay, Marissa Lewis, my lovely supervisor, is on the call, and she chimed in the chat. Lightcast, yes, it's a merge of Burning Glass and MC, so they used to be two separate tools, and now they are one. So that
Okay.
makes it, yeah. Go ahead.
No, thanks. I was going to say I won't, just like I said, I kind of detracted, got you off the course there. So I'll take it at that. Yeah, if you don't mind, maybe I'll email you sometime, and that would be awesome. Because I mean, like I said, I do Jobs EQ, so if I see how the other one like Lightcast works, I can definitely then make a comparison.
Right,
So.
you would then have enough information. Now, yeah, I've been able to do some pretty cool reports on there, especially since the merge. They've tried to make it very user friendly. So I think your question was certainly relevant. Okay, and we do have some people who've used both, so that's cool.
Okay, thank you so much. Maybe I'll
Yeah.
connect you some other time. Thank you.
No problem. So I did use Lightcast. If I did use Lightcast for these projections. And so we have the healthcare industry. And so this is by number of jobs. So this is the estimated increase in jobs in healthcare over the next 10 years, or for any healthcare accommodation and food. This is by industry. So we see healthcare at the top, and we see food and accommodation and transportation, right? Kind of at our our top four in professional and technical services. So those are your projected industries that are going to grow. And then on the next slide, we have the occupation projections. So still, healthcare, food prep is interesting because they are still at the top in terms of growth. So that will be all for projections. On the next slide, just as we think about these projections and just thinking about what makes it so that there is going to be different changes in demand, right? What sort of factors actually influence the job market? And I'd love to hear about some that I don't have listed, but like economic conditions, right? When we were, we had a recession so many years ago. We may be in one now, but we had a recession so many years ago, and that changed, right? Maybe people were willing to take less money because more people were being laid off. People may have been more motivated to work because they could not find jobs, or economic conditions such as inflation. Thank you, Kayla. The education system. Kayla, I'd love for you to say more about that if you want to, if you want to say something. I'd love for you to say more about that. I'll give you a chance. There you are.
I was just going to say, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I said the education system because we noticed a while ago, policy-wise, that they took, the trades programs out of the schools. So that's why we see so many jobs for blue-collar jobs that are always just open because, talent-wise, we just never addressed those skills. We moved away from that as we pushed higher education, which is great too, but I think we kind of did a disservice to ourselves for different manufacturing jobs, machine type of thing. So I think that's why we see a big gap in the American workforce system.
No, I think that's a really great point, right? Because people are not graduating high schools kind of with those base level skills, right? Some people were graduating and they had taken drafting courses or had taken, mechanics courses or what have you, and now we are not getting that same, job that job seeker that already kind of has some experience or even an idea necessarily of what they want to do. So I think that's something for us to think about with young people too. But to add to, did you have anything else to add, Kayla?
No, that's it. Thank you so much.
Okay. Technological advances, right? Those things would change the job market. When you have new technology, it just changes things, right? You don't need people in the same way. It doesn't mean that you don't still need jobs, but you may need those jobs to be done differently. So I'm thinking about the automotive industry right now. And when you think about being an auto mechanic, it was a very hands-on job. It was very much a dirty job. Well, now if you're working on a Tesla, if you're working on an electric vehicle, a hybrid vehicle, it may look very different. It has a lot more to do with technology, computers, programming, than maybe, oil changes, and some of the physical things. And then skills gaps, right? And so I think that directly correlates to Kayla's point about the education system. People just are learning different things now, right? So now these kids, they are born with phones in their hands. So they're actually probably moving around pretty well technologically, but they could be less inclined to talk to people. They could be facing some challenges when it comes to actually talking to real live, people, which is a skill you need for the job market. So love to see in the chat if people have other factors that I'm not really thinking about. But these factors, these things matter, and your locale matters, right? So I see that we have people all over Illinois, and so we know that the job market in rural Illinois might look a little bit different and then the job market in, a city like Chicago, and not only the types of jobs that are available, but then the ability of people to get to those jobs. So these are all things that we take into account when we're trying to help our customers and programs figure out, kind of figure out the job market. On the next slide, we're just a couple of points about how certifications enhance employability. And I'm sure that all of us here know this stuff, but number one, it validates your skills, right? So if I say that I know how to use Excel proficiently, And then now I have the certificate from Microsoft saying that I am, an expert Excel user or what have you. Then now my skills are valid. You don't just have to take my word for it. Industry recognition. Maybe my supervisor might say I'm good at a particular thing, but if I have a certification, the entire industry, the entire American Marketing Association or Grant Writers Association or whatever industry it is, right, is able to recognize it. It can give you a competitive advantage. While the certification may or may not be required for the job, it can certainly give you an advantage to say, hey, I have a certificate in, social media campaigning. But on the flip side of that, it may be required by an employer. In the hospital, nurses, they need to either be, the nursing assistants need to be certified nursing assistants. Your LPN has to actually be licensed. It is a requirement for your job. Whereas, I'm not a certified workforce development professional. I'm able to do this work, but I don't have that particular certification. These certifications can also help you stay updated, keep your skills updated. So you may have learned something 10 years ago, and it may look very different now. There may have been updates, there may have been changes, career advancement, and then networking. So while you're getting these certifications, if you are a part of a group and you're not like working independently, then it can be a really good opportunity for you to be able to network with other people who are in the field. So I want to jump into some in-demand certifications. On the next page, we have like a top 25 list. And then after that, we'll kind of go down by industry and I'll show you what Lightcast is saying about in-demand certification. So this is just a top 25 list. There's a lot on here. A lot in the healthcare industry. I think that is an industry that relies heavily, on certifications and like very specific requirements. But we also see things like certified public accountant, of course, commercial driver's license. So that's always going to be a big one. As many things as we order online and need them to like get to our homes. Project management. I won't read them all, but certified information systems, serve safe. So certified internal auditor, and then all the way down at the bottom, you see forklift, EMT, the Series 7. So this was just a top 25 list that kind of keeps coming up in job listings across the county. Absolutely. This will be shared with you. This slide list will be shared with you, Rachel. On the next slide, it's a little bit more broken down by industry because that was kind of a lot. So we look at our top certifications by industry. And again, this is pulled. I'll make sure I share the complete Where Are the Jobs report, although it's just a two-pager. It's kind of blown up for you here, but it's just a two-page report that kind of features that first chart that you saw, the top five employers. And then for each industry, we have eight industries that we break down. For each industries, we are looking at the top occupations, the top credentials, and then the top skills. So for the IT industry, software developers, web developers, project managers, computer user support specialists, and as well as systems analysts. So these are the top occupations that we are seeing job postings for in the IT industry. Then for credentials, you see the certified A plus, the PMP. The PMP actually keeps kind of popping up among a few different groups, but the certified information systems security professional. So there's a bunch of different versions of certified either network associates or professionals or securities professionals, and then skills. So just like the skills that they are looking for people to be able to use. So these are the ones that kept coming up, being able to do some programming, understanding databases, operating system. So this is probably the most, well, it is the most techie one because it's information technology. On the next slide, though, we see healthcare. And so you see your top occupations. It's no surprise. Definitely all of your nurses, whether they be registered or licensed, medical records and health information technicians, obviously nursing assistants, and then your medical and dental assistants and your pharmacy techs. So you're really seeing like your healthcare professionals. And then your support staff, all of those assistants and technicians help keep everything running. credentials. So there's the nursing, there is the nursing assistant or the license, the nursing, licensure, medical assistant. We are able to pay for those things through WIOA. They're also always wanting to see the first aid, the CPR, the advanced life support, the pharmacy tech credential. And then finally, skills. So these skills are a lot more personable than the ones from the IT section, but it's about patient care, knowing that you can schedule, knowing that you're able to communicate, and have some quality assurance. On the next slide, we're just going through all of the industries here. For food, the top occupations: waiters, waitresses, cooks, supervisors of food workers, hosts and hostesses, and dishwashers. And then for your credentials, there's the food handler serve safe, and then as well as the alcohol service certification, first aid CPR. I think that's another one that you see kind of weaved and throughout, because anytime there are just a lot of people around, it's always going to be a nice thing for people to be able to know how to do, perform first aid or CPR. You could also be a certified sous chef. There's also a cash handling certification. We have a program here at our sector center. So we have a food and hospitality sector center, and they actually have like an inventory management class that you can do for retail. So it goes over, they're able to get the serve safe if that's the direction. But for those who want to focus on like trying to get like a management job in retail or something, they can do the cash handling. And then there's like an inventory management certification that they can do. And then finally, under skills, you have cleaning, customer service, cooking, the things that you would think that are related to the food industry. On the next slide, we go into manufacturing. And again, I mentioned manufacturing is such an interesting it's an interesting industry to me right now, because it is number one, it has changed so much. It has become a lot more techie. When you go in these manufacturing plants, they're actually really clean. It's just not the same thing that you would imagine from like 20 or 30 years ago. But the top occupations are your production workers and machinists, your installation, maintenance, and repair workers, as well as your heating and air conditioning mechanics and installers, your supervisors, your inspectors, testers, sorters, samplers. And I think that last line is really important as you think about the food manufacturing industry. You have a lot of inspecting and testing going on. For your credentials, you see OSHA, you see welding, EPA, and for your skills, you got HVAC, hand tools, plumbing. So they're really looking for you to kind of be good with your hands naturally. On the next slide, we just have two or three, no, we got about three or four more. Transportation, so top occupations, your truck drivers, all different kinds, heavy, light, and delivery drivers. You got your laborers and your packers and your packagers. So a company like Amazon, so it's always interesting how these things are laid out, because your transportation, it really is transportation, distribution, and logistics. So it is the movement of It's a movement of things, but it's also the logistics that go with that. So all of your package handlers, your people who are packing it, your operators, even your driver sales workers. For the credentials here, various forms of the commercial driver's license, so Class A, Class B, and C, the Automotive Service Excellence Certification, the forklift operator. These things have to be moved, hazmat and OSHA, as well as being a diesel mechanic. For your skills, repair, forklift operation, customer service, being able to drive, and being able to schedule. Next, office and administrative. For your top occupations, you see your customer service reps, your secretaries, your bookkeeping and accounting clerks. I hate to read each one of them, because I know that you are all able to read and see them. So I'll just focus in on the credentials. Your top credentials in this field is being a paralegal, a number of insurance and financial licenses, that PMP, the project management certification. You could also be a certified payroll professional or a certified protection professional. On the next slide, sales. So you see the top occupations here, but these insurance licenses, so that is big on sales. So you got your life insurance, your health insurance, accident insurance, property insurance, and then you have like real estate licenses, mortgage licenses, again, and then the cash handling for sales. And then the final industry that we're taking a look at, just kind of zooming in on, is the business and finance industry on the next slide. And so and under business and finance, you see your it's a little bit more diverse over here. You see your management and HR specialists, but you also see your accountants, auditors, and market research and marketing, as well as personal financial advisors. There are a number of credentials associated with this. The certified public accountant, your securities licenses, project management, or you could be a professional, the PHR or SPHR, for human resources. So those are just broken down by industry. This is something that we include in everywhere the jobs report, and it changes from quarter to quarter. So it's always good to see, which occupations have kind of moved around, and what things have stayed the same. So I want to talk a little bit about some tools that you can use, even if you do not have a paid membership to Lightcast. So on the next slide, to just talk about the BLS, Bureau of Labor Statistics Occupational Outlook Handbook. You can always, you have a young person who wants to do something. Maybe they want to be an exercise physiologist, or whatever they might want to do. You can go onto this handbook and then search that particular occupation, because when you're looking at so much broad data, is there's a bunch of occupations, under each occupation group. So sometimes it's helpful to see the big picture and say, oh, the transportation industry is set to grow, or oh, this occupation, there are a lot of openings for this as a group. But it's better when you're able to take an individual job that someone actually wants. And you can see what the median pay was. You can see what the typical entry-level education is. You can see the work experience. You can see whether the outlook is set to grow. So, on the first page of the handbook, you always just find like the summary giving you the high level. But then if you want more information about the skills and the certifications that would be connected to that, you would click on how to become one. So I have a screenshot on the next slide. And this is still same from that same site. So here, this is where you find out what is typically required. So I did end up choosing this occupation, which you need a bachelor's degree for. So we there's that. But in terms of licenses, they typically want to see, CPR, BLS. There are other, and then there's also like these optional certifications, right? From different groups, the American Society of Exercise Physiologists and the American College of Sports Medicine. So each industry, you also are able to learn about which professional organizations are connected to a particular occupation or industry, because these are typically the groups that are actually giving you that are offering either the professional development or the certification. So on the next slide, we could talk a little bit about some emerging sectors. So, and I'd love for people to let me know about some that I have not listed, but emerging sectors. So some of the things I'm thinking about are electric vehicles, right? Anything related to renewable energy. I don't have this listed, but like your solar panels, right? Artificial intelligence, 3D printing, robotics, drones. And blockchain, which is another form of like fintech, they call it financial tech, virtual reality, self-driving cars, biotechnology. And as we think about these sectors, I'd love to just pause and hear if people have any wants to add, or any thoughts about how these sectors impact the existing industries. So like electric vehicles, that's going to impact the transportation industry, not only on our level, like as consumers who drive regular cars, but they may impact, our public transit system. Now we have some electric buses, that are going around, or the commercial industry, right? Trucks, electric trucks, going around. Other things, AI, right? Artificial intelligence, how some of the reports maybe that we have been analyzing and having to do on our own, now we have some AI tools that can help us do that. So it may impact thing it may impact industries that were more reliant on people physically reading and going over things. I think we'll always need people, right? But there are some industries that could certainly be disrupted by these emerging sectors. And it also is an opportunity for us to kind of get in earlier at the ground level to start to prepare people, to start to prepare people for these sectors. Did anybody have anything they wanted to say about the emerging sectors? Have they noticed changes in their local job market as a result of these? We have Dana.
Hi, my name is Dana Nguyen. I'm the director for clean energy programs at the Illinois Community College Board. This is a new position that my agency has established. I just began on March 1st, so my role is specifically, so clean energy programs is the focus, but right now I'm specifically working with the development in at the community colleges. Right now we have 25 community colleges. But we're working on the electric vehicle or electric vehicles. I know this summer the our kind of our, one of our partners that's helping facilitate the electric vehicle the EV network that's a statewide network for curriculum development and training is our partners at the Illinois Green Economy Network or iGEN. And they're facilitating and helping coordinate the trainings through. There's a few different options. Some colleges had specific trainings that they were interested in, kind of based on previous trainings that faculty have trained. But so we are, and we just announced a second round in funding that will begin July 1st. So we currently have 25 colleges in our, first round of this initiative. That's a statewide or a state supported, funding initiative. And I also want to speak to that as far as like electric vehicles and the renewable energy. The state is definitely a huge player in the development and, championing that work at the statewide level. Right. And so I think that building kind of the credentials that are available. And so this is where I wanted to just highlight two things that I am seeing in the electric vehicle development space. Colleges right now in this first round have identified that they're working to establish certificates for electric vehicle service technicians and high voltage battery certificates. And the high voltage battery certifications or certificates that are developed will also be transferable to the hydrogen economy as it develops in the state. I serve on the hydrogen economy task force for the state on behalf of my agency. So this is something that is in development, and I can definitely share my contact information if anybody wants to reach out. And that's all I wanted to add.
Thank you so much. That is good to know. Are you incorporating? Oh, okay. More questions for you in the chat. I think another thing that I'm thinking about when you think about emerging sectors and like emerging occupations and preparing our workforce for it, like there's all this like e-commerce and digital marketing, and these are concepts that did not exist like 20 years ago, 30 years ago to say like, yes, I am a digital nomad and I just do open marketing and web development like in the independently. So this is but there are lots of people doing it. So it becomes an emerging sector. So on the next slide, I'm actually wrapping up a lot of the information. But this is a good like point for a discussion. So I just want to talk about using this information to build stronger programs. Like, how can we use the data that we have, the research that we have, to either help ourselves, if that's your role, to program develop or program design, or support your team in doing this. So number one, just using what you know, right? So we know about job markets. Oh, thank you, Rory. We know about like these industries and what jobs are there. Some industries are kind of tried and true, like the transportation or food industry, and some are evolving. But whatever it is, use what you know to begin to target certain industries, certifications, and employers. And looking at external and internal trends. So today, I mainly talked about the external sources that I'm using to analyze labor market information, right? I'm looking at what the Bureau of Labor Statistics saying. I'm looking at what all of these millions of job leads on Indeed are saying. But there's also the ability to look internally and look for trends. So one of the research projects that I undertook at my organization was to look at some special populations and look at where we've had success placing them. So this was initially born from us getting a new grant to do some reentry work and wanting to come up with like a top 40 list for returning citizens. Like I would love to have like a top 40 jobs for returning citizens. So I went about the business of like Googling that and trying to find that list online, and it didn't. The things that I were finding, they just didn't seem like they were backed by any real research. It just seems like it, like any blogger had just like put up a list, like, oh, these would be good jobs for returning citizens. So I asked myself, I'm like, well, why don't I look internally at out at the population of people within our system that have identified themselves as a returning resident, and then let's see where we've had success at with placing them. So that's what we did. I looked back at the last 5 years and said, okay, how many people indicated that they were a returning citizen? That number was a little bit under 2,500. So that was, a nice end to start with. And then, we just went of those, 2,500, we ended up placing maybe about 1,500 of them at ex you know, they that were exited with employment. And then just looking like, where did they work? So I think the trends I found with them were manufacturing, transportation, and food service. So those were kind of the top three industries once we looked at like, where are they actually working? And another good thing that came out of that was looking for the trends in the employers that were hiring them, because then we noticed like, oh, this employer has hired, 15, 10, 11, 12, however many returning citizens. So now we can use that information to target that employer and see, since they've already shown that they are close to the work and open to supporting this effort. Now we can work with them to maybe design a customized training program, some sort of a cohort model, or to just work with them on a job fair, or just to continue to receive referrals, or just even to just engage that employer and like uplift the work that they're doing. Like, thank you. Thank you for how you're working with us. Ended up doing a similar analysis for persons with disabilities as well as opportunity youth. So remember that you have the external stuff that you can look at. You can use these tools, BLS and all of these things, but you can also, the majority of us have data, have outcomes. And sometimes I think we overlook that as a very valuable source of information. Survey your target population. So I've worked in some youth programs over the years, and one of the things that we would do is, have the young person, complete that survey. Hey, if these jobs were available, which jobs would you be willing to do? And we maybe had about 20 to 25 occupations that we thought did not require a college, didn't require a college degree, that we thought that they should be able to get. And it was everything from being like a veterinary assistant to being like a cashier, working at a warehouse, all these different types of jobs. And just finding out how many of them are interested in what. And then finally, when you think about how you're going to get, these different certifications, make these different certifications available to your customers. Remember, multiple instruction methods. So, boot camps online, in person. Coursera has done some really cool things. I mean, it has to be what's best for the person because every person just doesn't like necessarily to do everything online. But utilizing multiple instruction methods is helpful. And there, I see some activity in the chat, and I just wanted to take some time here and see if people had any feedback, anything to say about how you either have used data to help build a stronger program, or how you might do it in the future, or are there some internal ways that you can now look at your data that you had not thought about before? Anybody have anything? And if not, that will be okay. I have more discussion questions on the next slide. Okay, so I am nearing the close of my formal presentation, but I'd love for us to just talk about things. So, how can we remain responsive to changes in the job market? So, if we're seeing shifts in demand, like for certain skills, at first you didn't need this skill and now you need it, or emerging industries. Does anyone have any feedback on any of these questions? What strategies could we implement to help us more agile and flexible in our program design? Or how can we better collaborate with local employers to find out what they need and then align our training programs accordingly?
Dana has her hand raised, so I'll allow her to talk.
Hi, Jasmine. I had just wanted to know who, as far as reaching local businesses in Southern Illinois, this, even though my agency works statewide and everything in the electric vehicle programs is pretty well, even the round one is pretty well distributed. I was just curious, do you know the who the Southern Illinois kind of counterpart is to your organization, the Chicago Cook Workforce Partnership? If you don't right now, that's fine. But I'm just wondering so that, maybe I can kind of reach out to build that connection. I think that something that in our Southern Illinois region, we could really tap into, is I don't know, facilitating conversations and some kind of events with incumbent workers from other industries that have either dropped out of the workforce during the pandemic, before, after, otherwise. And then because they do have those valuable employability skills, kind of our foundation. But then we need to bring them up to that next level. So there's some of that retraining and advanced trainings for those incumbent workers, and basically getting into those industries. So I think definitely working really stronger working relationships with community partners are valuable to really developing the work. That's
Thank
all.
you. No, yeah, thank you. And those incumbent worker training programs, or any group training program, especially one that is connected to an employer, is just always a good it's always a good idea. Do people have other examples of partnering with M? And they did answer your question, Dana. If you can see in the chat, I think they are providing you with the information so that you can find out who your local workforce area is in Southern Illinois, because I am not aware of who it is. But thank you for that. Do people have any other stories of cool collaboration where they were able to collaborate with an employer to either design a custom training program for a specific industry or to assist a group of people with gaining like an in-demand certification? Seeing that there are none, we can go to the next slide. It just has a few more questions to think about. Are there any incentives or partnerships that we could establish to foster more engagement? How can these statistics inform efforts to promote equity and inclusion in workforce development? And then how can they be utilized to advocate for funding and resources? So I definitely use it in this way when I'm writing grants, because if we have a sector-based grant, for instance, we have a grant called Construction Works, and the goal is to increase the amount of underrepresented groups who are entering the construction trades. So I'm able to use job market statistics to show that there are less women and less people of color who are in these in the construction industry, actually working in the construction industry, than there are of other groups. So there's you can always use those statistics to prove that there is either an imbalance in the people who are in there. Do people have any feedback on any? Carolyn, please speak up and join us. We use our reports. And so, and maybe if you don't mind, say a little bit about the reports that you do. Like, what are some of the things you keep in your report?
Sure. Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. So we use a lot of the same reports, Jasmine, that you're using. We'll use the where the jobs are, the jobs posting report. We also have the hard skills and soft skills report that we put together using Lightcast. And so what we'll do is we have those reports on our website, but then we do special reports for each municipality and break it down. It gives us an opportunity to engage with them, and give them some information. We'll also do wage reports, and we'll do a lot of that for developers who are coming into the area. So if someone's coming into the area, they're going to hire a certain number of, occupations. We will run reports for them so that we can show them what the average wage is in the region. And then we'll do a demographic breakdown as well. We've also done the skills gap and the education report, and we've given those to the developers. Probably the one that most look at from a consistent basis is the where the jobs are, because it'll show the amount of time that a position's posted, the duration before it's filled. That's a really great way of engaging the employers and saying, do you have a workforce issue or do you have a wage issue, right? Because if it's taking you too long, there may be a gap there. And then the other that we utilize often is with our employers who are thinking about, a promotion of an internal candidate, or maybe they just have gone sort of wild, wild west and they haven't given raises in a while. And you say, this is why people are leaving you. It's not necessarily for the quarter more that they could make down the street, but the reality is they can get tuition up front and not tuition reimbursement or no tuition, which is what you're offering. So we try to give them some compensation information to make better decisions on retention.
And I hope that has a nice impact on job quality, right?
Yeah,
Because, yeah.
it helps us because, like you said, just when you're trying to go for a grant, when you're writing for a grant, data is important. And so when you're working with an employer, they're not going to believe Caroline, who's trying to, get them engaged in the local workforce area. They're going to believe the statistics of their peers and what they're paying and why someone maybe is looking to leave. So we've been using that a lot with retention. And then we also couple that with the incumbent worker training dollars. And we'll say, if you worked with your employees in this particular, so one is transportation warehouse logistics is huge in Will County. Will County's home to the largest inland port in North America. So that is a huge industry for us. And what we'll have is we'll have employers that the truck driver has to, in order to go through the yard, they have to cross a street. Well, to cross the street, they have to have a CDL. So we're like, let's work on getting more of your employees to get a CDL. That will upskill them. If you pay for it, which is means we're going to pay for it under a incumbent worker training grant, then that's going to upskill them. And now that'll be reflected in their pay, and that will help with retention, as well as it will help product move around in the yard, which is what they want. So, it's been really good in coupling the services that we can provide, utilizing the programs that are under WIOA, coupled with the data, or at least backed up by the data.
Thank you so much. That was super helpful.
Sure.
And I think you have a question. I don't know if Kayla's question is for Rory's comment. Rory, I don't know if you want to say it out loud, but I'm happy to read it. I love what you're saying about connecting with chambers of commerce, finding out what jobs are harder to fill. Rory, yep. Feel free to speak up.
Oh, no. And I'm guessing Kayla, I saw Kayla's comment come in the chat, and it came in like right on the heels of mine. So I'm guessing she might have been, maybe that question might be more for was it? I think Caroline was just speaking. It's probably for her. Or if it's for me, we do work with a lot. Like a business services division that does work a lot with local employers, trying to ask, how can we help you, with your needs for hiring, growth, staying competitive, those types of things. So it's basically what I said in the chat. We one of the things we've done to varying degrees of success over the years is starting with it's not the only thing we've done. One of the things that is working with the chambers of commerce, and then from there you start to get okay, what employers they can spread the word. Then they come in, they hear, or you meet with them, they learn about services that the Workforce Development Division or the American Job Center or whatever has. And then they can disseminate that to, employers in the region that the chamber works with. And then, kind of trickles down from, kind of spreading the word from there. And then, making connections with and building rapport, with those employers. And then over the years, we've had various like panels. I mean, we have task force, work group, but we kind of maybe call them panels sometimes invite some of them. Often you get a lot of them sometimes that are very willing to come into your job club, or we call them career conversations, and then speak, to the job seekers directly about, kind of what they're hiring. But more importantly for those employers then, to communicate with us. And then that helps us get an idea, because, and there's still some, I mean, you mentioned manufacturing, and that's a very interesting one and always kind of elusive to find, a lot of good, even using tools like, MC or JobsEQ to find. Now, I think now in the last few years, more and more of those jobs are getting posted online, but, there's still so many of those that, just a sign in front of the building, help wanted, or through word of mouth, or somebody knows somebody. A lot of those old traditional ways of posting, if you will, or not even posting, we're just of hiring. A lot of particularly in manufacturing, a lot of those companies still kind of use those methods and rely on them. And I think it's only because of the competitive nature, or not being aware of what other companies are paying, kind of going back, I think what Caroline was saying, I think that's probably what's prompted them now to start doing more, online posting. And I can't speak for, all across the state. I know in our area, I think with some manufacturing companies, that's what has maybe sort of prompted that shift. But yeah, if they're not posting a lot of those jobs electronically, then
I'm sure it's the same thing.
But they're just not being captured. I didn't want to cut you off, Carolyn, if you were going to say something else. I do have a question, though, for Rory. With your work with the chambers, you were saying that you were collecting that information from the employers about what their training needs are. Are you or anyone, is anyone using a formal tool to collect that information, like some sort of survey or something, or is it just a conversation saying, hey, I know you're if you're in the business engagement department and you're just kind of having a one-on-one conversation, but I'd love to know if you have a specific tool that you are using to collect and kind of keep track of that information. Rory, are you there? That was a question.
No, I was blabbing for forever there. I was giving some other people a chance to talk. So yeah, I was kind of done. Yeah, to answer your question quickly so that others can participate. We've done both, in whatever, sometimes it's the informal because you may get a call like, oh, hey, out of the blue from that you didn't expect. So, and it leads to a meeting. So, both, that and certain types of surveys, that can be sent out as well, I think.
Okay, and I see the other two responses, Dana and Caroline. Thank you. You survey employers to learn more about their compensation packages. Yes, exactly. I agree. That is something that is missing from like CAS. It's always you always kind of want to know, like, are these full time with benefits? Like, what are when you're kind of trying to assess the quality of the job, right? Because the pay is just one, and as you know, is really only listed for about 30 to 40% of the jobs in like CAS. A lot of them, just like, because of the way job leads are, they do not, they don't always list the compensation, or even sometimes they may list the range, which is not range, which is not specific. And I also appreciate your comment, and feel free to speak up if you'd like to speak out loud. But I do appreciate your comment, and I'm glad that this has been helpful for you. On the next slide, don't really have a lot left, but I'm happy we are more than welcome to continue this discussion. Just resources, Bureau of Labor Statistics, that leads right into your Occupational Outlook Handbook, where the screenshots were from earlier. Illinois WorkNet, we should probably all be aware of that. That is a free tool, and there is an LMI page. And then this interesting little site that I found, the Opportunity Insights Economic Tracker, is Track the Recovery. So this is like a site that has come up post-COVID, and it really has just been looking at like different industries across the US and how they've recovered, like if jobs are at or above or below the pre-2020 levels. So for some of us, that's relevant. And that is all the information that I like to present today. I'm very happy to have been here, and I really appreciate everyone and their feedback and chiming in and sharing resources. And if people have more to say, then I'm happy to hang out. But if not, that is all I have for today.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jasmine. Does anyone have any other questions or comments they would like to ask, Jasmine? This has been a great discussion today, so thank you all for participating. Just to wrap things up, again, this was recorded and it will be on Illinois WorkNet as well as our Illinois Workforce Academy website. You will have an email tomorrow from Zoom with the follow-up survey, as well as the link to the recording and the presentation. So you can have access to that. I can actually share the presentation today in the chat for everyone really quickly if I just stop sharing my screen here. I'll go ahead and put the PDF in the chat for you all. You should have access to it if you'd like to download it. And then I think we'll wrap things up. Thank you so much, Jasmine, for sharing your insights today. We appreciate your presentation, and thank you everyone for joining us. Have a great rest of your Wednesday and enjoy the beautiful weather.
Thanks. Thank you for having me.